Welcome, friends, to the second day of our three-day meditation workshop in Rice Lake, Wisconsin. I'm very happy to see you all again here. Back to M&M. I said yesterday we are on M&M, but not the candy. Meditation and merger. True meditation leads to merger. True meditation leads to the merger with the ultimate truth, the ultimate creative power, whatever name you give it to it. It's the ultimate, it's only one. And we all merge into that. When one soul merges into the ultimate, in our true home, Sachkhand, it's not an experience of one soul merging into a place that is distant from it. It's an awakening of the one to its own reality. And therefore, the experience a soul has, an experience a soul in a human body has through meditation to go to that level of merger while still in the human body and experience the entire creation, including the self that we thought was our real self, in all its forms, everything merging at one time into that one. It's a complete merger. There is no experience that I can possibly think of, imagine or have, which is beyond that experience in its bliss, ecstasy and joy. And experience of love put all together, all the love of the world put together cannot match that. And that experience is within our reach, within a human lifetime. The greatest miracle of all, I can't think of a greater miracle at all, that this possibility exists for a human being. But just to tell you a little story, I thought of it that I am mentioning candy. Candy can also be important. When I was a small baby, my father and mother were already disciples of Great Master, which was an advantage to me and a disadvantage. It was an advantage because I started knowing my master at a very early age. The first time I saw him, I am told I was only 29 days old. So that's a pretty good early start. But the disadvantage was that just because I was born in a satsangi family, followers of Great Master, I questioned whether the belief system was merely because I was born in a certain family. That had I been born in a Christian family, I would have been worshipping Christ. Had I been born in a Muslim family, I would have been worshipping Muhammad. That just by accident of my birth, I am following something, that's not right. That's not fair to a seeker. A seeker of truth must have all options open to it. So this was both an advantage and a disadvantage to me. But today I think it was an advantage. And I'll tell you the candy story. When I was still very small, when Great Master could carry me like a baby in his arms, he did used to carry me in the dera and take me to the candy shop, which we call the sweetmeat shop. Mithai ki dukaan, mithai. They sold Indian sweets. And he would buy a sweet called barfi, a milk product that used to come in little pieces. And he used to pay for that from his inner waist pocket. I must tell you, there were no banks there. There were donations coming in, which were for the dera, which he never used for his personal use. He used to wear an inner waistcoat, little pocket. When his pension money used to come after retirement, he put that money in the inner pocket. What were donated for the dera, which he only used for the dera and for people, for the langar, for the kitchen, that he put in a long cloak he used to wear on top with the big pocket outside. I didn't realize till later the significance of the fact that he gave me that barfi, that candy, out of the money from the inner waistcoat pocket, from his own earning. He treated me like I was one of his own and not that I was just one of the followers, which he handled with the pocket outside. That was quite an impact later on when I realized it. But the bigger impact was that the barfi tasted so good. The taste of it has never gone away. I can still taste it in my mouth today after 89 years. So that's why some candy can be really good. That was really good candy. Now, talking about these donations that they got, he built a conference center called the Dera, and he built it. We worked on it. I used to carry a brick. It was made of bricks mostly. I used to carry one brick on my head as part of the seva. There was a mastana from Baluchistan. We used to walk together for the seva. And the mastana of Baluchistan used to carry a big basket. He was much bigger, taller than me. I was small. I carried one brick. He carried the big basket. On the way, we used to discuss inner experiences which we were having. It was great. I can never forget that experience of that seva. That serving of the master for fulfilling his dream. His dream was to have a place where they could have their meetings and not have to sit under a tree to have a meeting, not to have a tent, but to have a building just for meetings, which he was doing, as I realized, as a tribute to his own master, Baba Jamal Singh. And he named it Dera Baba Jamal Singh. It still stands on the bank of the river Bias in India. He predicted in 1936 and 1937, and I was about 11 years old, he told me and told another satsangi named Julian Johnson, Dr. Johnson, that the axis of spirituality is going to shift to the West. For many centuries, great masters, perfect living masters have been born in the East, in China, India, the Middle East, but very few have come on the West. Some have come stretched right up to some parts of Europe. But the new world has not seen them. They are still worshipping nature. They are still worshipping the principles of creative power outside, not inside. But masters will come there. And several masters will come. In fact, there will be more masters in the West than there ever been in the East. Because as this Kali Yuga proceeds, there will be a change in the pattern of seeking of the people of this world. That the people in the East who were happy with their poverty so long as their spiritual values, and the people of the West who are happy with making money, getting affluence, making big factories, big buildings, they're happy with that. This happiness will disappear. The poverty will become a curse in the East and affluence will become a curse in the West. Poverty will lead to trying to make riches in the East. And they will be great countries of the East. The one that produced the best perfect living masters will run after making more money, run after building factories, building industries, and grow economically. And the West, after all economic growth, will find that they have not solved the problem of human suffering, that they have not solved the problem of sadness amongst people, will turn to spirituality. He predicted this will happen. In fact, to tell you the truth, why did I come to this country? I came to watch this transition, the transitional show. I came quickly enough to be able to sit on the ringside of this show. And I'm watching the show right now. Because of this prediction he made, which I am seeing is actually taking place right now. Therefore, I feel that there will be so many masters coming here. And just like my master paid a tribute to his master, I decided I want to pay a tribute to my master. I know that there's nothing in outside buildings. This is the building, the human body is the building in which we have to go in to find the truth. But sitting in this created world, we are meeting here in a building. We've come to a golf club to have a meeting. We sometimes have gone to churches for meetings. Sometimes we go on to unknown places for meetings. Wouldn't it be better if we have our own place, like Great Master decided to have his own place? That is why I announced a few years ago that we will have our own place, which I want to dedicate. It's my dream to have dedicated building where we'll assemble. Not only we'll assemble, several masters will come and assemble and carry on the work of the great master, which I am just transitioning. I'm bringing it here as a servant of great master. I have never claimed to be a master. I have always said, do I look like one? I tell jokes in my meetings. Do masters tell jokes? I go to casinos. Do masters go to casinos? I'm not dressed like a master. I don't look like one. So nobody should mistake about that. But I am his servant, sevadar of the great master, Hadur Maharaj Baba Savan Singh. And I'm carrying it, his mandate. Everything I'm doing now is strictly according to his instruction and mandate. Nothing more nor less. I have never departed from that. So that's why this is my seva. You think I'm doing it for you? I'm doing it for myself. We are all selfish people. This is my seva to my guru. And whatever I do with that building is also my seva to my guru, a tribute to the greatness of the man who transformed the lives of thousands of people. And I watched them. The transition of life, the transformation of life taking place. So that's why, in the very first meeting when I made an announcement, I asked people, would you like to help me to make that? And several hands went up. And I am very happy that we were able to find builders, architects amongst those people. We also found people who were willing to donate their time, donate their money to help me in that doing so. Now when I travel around the world, in almost every event I have attended, people ask me, we want to help. We can't come and help you there with our labor. Can we send some money? I said, yes, you can send it. Contact Jonathan, contact so and so. But still so many of them don't know about it. I thought I should do what great master did. The building of the Dera in India took place not with one multimillionaire coming and set it up. It took place with the participation of the poorest of the Satsangi's followers, the great master. Even one rupee, less than a few cents here, was accepted as equal to 1,000,000 rupees. There was no difference. Whatever one could afford was the right donation for them. That's how it is built up with everybody's. It's a great cumulative effort that you can see in that building in India. And there's a story about the Sikh gurus, that one of the gurus was giving a discourse. In those days, it was a tradition never to go empty-handed to a guru to carry something. Either you carry some cash as a donation, or you carry flowers, or you carry food, or you carry some grains for the kitchen. Everybody carried something. So nobody went empty-handed. Nobody went empty-handed to see a guru. That was just tradition, still a tradition kept up in India. People don't come empty-handed, they come with something. And the guru does not take it for himself. Every guru, perfect living master, has worked for his living, has an inner pocket for himself and his family. But whatever else is there is used for the work he's doing in serving people and giving them the message of spiritual truths. The story goes that there was a very poor man. He heard that his guru is coming to give a discourse. He told his wife, I know we have no money right now, but search for something. There should be some money. I can't go empty-handed to see the guru. She looked over, she said, you know, we spent the last penny on our groceries, which were very few, and now we have nothing in our hands. He said, look around, there may be some coins dropped here or there. And when they looked around, in a corner they found a kauri, which is the smallest coin in those days, less than a penny of American coins. Let's say call it a penny for now, that they found a rusted penny on one corner. He picked it up, he said, at least it is something. I'm not going empty-handed. So he put the penny in his turban and went to attend the guru's discourse. The guru gave his discourse. All the rich people were sitting in front And they all made their offerings. They laid money, fruit, whatever they brought, vegetables, grain, bags, whatever they put right in front of the guru. And the guru gave his discourse. Then he said, anybody else wants to give something? This poor man sitting at the back, he said, I'm in front of these people, I can't give a penny. He felt so ashamed of himself. I just brought a penny and these people are giving thousands. What will I look like to say I'm giving a penny to you? He kept back with tears in his eyes and he wouldn't get up. The guru sat there. Discourse ended. His attendant said, sir, master, it is time for lunch now. He said, wait, I'm waiting for some more gifts to come in. He said, master, everybody has given their gifts. They made an announcement. Anybody else who has to give a donation, please come up. Nobody came. They said, we have all given our donations. We came. Master still sat there. His attendant said, please come and have lunch. He said, no, I'm waiting for a gift. Nobody got up. So master got up and walked to the end. And we came to this man. And he said, why are you ashamed? He said, I have brought nothing. He said, no, you brought something for me. He said, it's so small compared to these people. I feel ashamed to give it to you. Master put his hand in his turban, took out the penny. He said, this penny is worth more than 1,000,000 rupees for me. And you will get rewarded for this penny more than all the rich people sitting in front. And he got the biggest spiritual blessing out of all the people who were giving those big amounts of money there. This story is told to show that it is not what you give. It's with what heart you give. Even the smallest thing you give for this cause of this kind is equally valuable. Masters are not counting what you're giving. They're counting with what heart you brought it, with what feelings you brought it. So I wanted to tell you this story. If some people who tell me in the different events, we want to help you, we want to give you, and then they feel shy that maybe we can't afford what other people can afford, please give up that idea. If you want to give for that building that I am constructing to fulfill my dream of paying tribute to my master, I'll accept $1 as valuable as $1,000,000. And there'll be no difference in that. One who gives me $1 with the same heart as one who gives $1,000,000 are both equal for me. And that is why I wanted to make it clear. Then I also told Jonathan that I sent people to you. Then they tell me we could not help you because we don't know where to help you. So I said, let people know that there is some system. What was the system in Great Master's time? That there were no check writings. There were no banks. So people had to bring little money in their hands. And Great Master set about a separate time when he would give the prasad to people. At the same time, they could also give their offering to him. So it was a system which was working just because he would have a satsang, where he would have a separate time for prasad, and at that time there was time for what they called seva. Seva was of three kinds. We all love to have seva of different kinds. We all want to seva of every kind. Seva with money was the easiest seva. Anybody could bring some money and put in there. Seva with labor was the next best seva because we had to work along with others without showing off who's big or who's small. And seva with the mind was to go and meditate for the master and not for yourself as an offering. We enjoyed all three kinds of seva. It was a great experience for us. So if the spiritual heritage of that great master is shifting here, I thought I'd share these truths with you and share these traditions with you. I don't know how far they're applicable to the current Western culture, how they're applicable to current Western values, but I thought I'll share with you. And of course, I would like to know how many of you would still like to help me in the building of that dera. I'm so very happy to see all of you. My dream will be fulfilled. I know that. Talking about the seva and about working together, what we used to call mitti seva. Mitti means dirt, earth, dust, mud. We used to work with that because the dera was on the bank of a river and the river had bluffs on it, and we had to fill up those some hollow places. So we would dig the earth, we dig the dirt from one place and pour it somewhere else. We all enjoyed doing it. When the building came up, we all enjoyed carrying those bricks. There was a colonel in Minneapolis. He was looking for a master. And this was, of course, much later this happened. But the Bitti Seva tradition was still going on in the Dera. This colonel was the colonel of the Air Force. And he used to get free rides on the Air Force planes when they were going towards Guam or Tokyo or those places. So some of his planes would go over India, and he found out about the great master and the other master who were living in North India. So he decided to go and meet one of them. He heard there was a Dera on the bank of the river Bias. So he would search for the river Bias. He couldn't find it because the river was B-E-A-S, which he always pronounced bees. He crossed several times over river Bees, but never found the river Bias. Somebody then told him once that you are missing the river every time. So then he went and was able to make it to the Dera Bias. When he reached there, Mitti Seva was going on. People were carrying dirt, people were working, they were all full of dust. And he had a suitcase with him. And he took the suitcase and he called one of those guys, "Hey, come here, can you carry my suitcase? I have got a reservation in a guest house here." And, "Oh, yes, sir. Oh, you speak English? Very good." So the man carried his suitcase to the guest house and he took out a dollar bill. He said, "Here's a tip for you. This is a US American dollar. It's much more valuable than your rupee. So I'm giving you a good tip." He said, "Sir, I don't take tips. Thank you very much. I did some seva. I'm doing seva for you. It's like seva for my master." No. "Accept this tip." "No, sir. Please forgive me." In the evening, there was a meeting, and he found a man in a suit and tie sitting next to him with the master. And he looked at him. He looked like the same guy who carried his suitcase. He asked somebody on the left side, "Who is this guy sitting next to me?" He says, "Oh, he's a big, rich guy. He's a multimillionaire. He owns so many factories. He owns so much stuff." He turned around. "Did you carry my suitcase today?" He says, "Yes, sir, I did." What happened in the seva was there was no distinction between a millionaire and a poor man. This was the greatest leveler of people that met the seva. We enjoyed that because everybody was equal there. And I must tell you, in the eyes of a master, everyone is equal. We sometimes think they are not. And sometimes people who are close to master, they think they are bosses. We had a meeting of the Isha board of directors. Isha is the Institute for the Study of Human Awareness that organizes these meetings. And you all know about it because Isha invites you to come to these meetings. We were having a board meeting, a second board meeting where we had all the coordinators and all the other sevadars who worked, volunteers who worked for Isha, present. And there I asked Diane to read out a letter from a man from Europe who had written to me. He was a poor man. He wanted to come and see me. He was poor. He had great difficulty collecting enough money to buy a rail ticket, traveling 13 hours in the rail ticket, with the rail ticket to come and see me. When he came there, people looked down upon him because he was poor. He felt he was discriminated just because of his poverty. Nobody cared what kind of seeker he was. They created obstacles in his way that people who thought they were in charge of the program thought they were big bosses and they could now control people. You know, this is a very common weakness we have. When we are given a little authority over something, we try to think we become big. And now we can exercise our authority on people who are now different from us and small. That is totally opposite of what the spiritual teachings tell us. Look at the life of these masters themselves, how much humble they are. They don't claim to be masters. They serve people. They are themselves an example of humility, and people who work around and serving other people, they should follow that example and be as humble as possible. Some people have difficulty in coming here. We should assist them rather than be unkind and say that no, as if we have got extraordinary power. We are not policing anybody here. It's not that they are giving any ranks that you are higher and lower. And that's why I said this Mitti Seva was a great example. Everybody is equal. And I must tell you, in the eyes of a master, everybody is equal at all times, not only during Mitti Seva. So therefore, people who serve, who come as volunteers to do Seva, the Sevadars, it's my special appeal to them to be extra kind, extra humble in serving the others who are coming as seekers of the truth. So we were a little pained, all of us, to hear that letter. And I hope that we will not have these experiences. And I must confess that was not the only letter of its kind I received. I received more than one. And it pains me to see that we who say we are sevadars, who are serving people, should assume to ourselves that we have a special power because we are close to Master, or that we have been given a special duty which gives us authority over people. We should not be treated like that. We should serve with humility and take an example from the masters themselves, that they have been very humble people. And those who were arrogant were not masters at all. So that is why I wanted to bring this to your notice and say, any one of those who ever gets a chance to do seva, please do it with such humility. And remember that we all have come from the status of beggars. We all come as beggars, begging for something. Just because we got something does not make them higher or lower than anybody. We are all equal. Now, having said all these announcements, and brought these points to your notice, we come back to Hamadan, meditation and merger. When you have one experience of total merger, that experience never leaves you. Before that, every experience leaves you. You have a dream, you wake up, dream is gone. Why is it gone? Two reasons. One, the current reality has opened up. Everything else is unreal automatically. So dream was unreal. You woke up. Woke up into what? Into a reality. No illusions have been created. Realities have been created. This is a wakeful reality. If this was not a wakeful reality, there was no role of a living master in this. We would be searching somewhere else. It's a reality being created in which we have real experiences, in which we have real masters and real disciples. So a reality has come up and we accepted this as real, and therefore we forgot the dreams meant nothing. They were just dreams. What happens if you have a higher experience? Supposing you have a higher experience like Faheen had the experience that he was a butterfly flying in a different area where flowers were giving lights. Then he went to the astral plane. If you have an astral dream where the colors like blue and yellow shine up, which don't shine up in dreams, they shine up in the astral dreams. Supposing you have that kind of an astral dream or an astral experience, and you come back to the reality, that becomes dreamlike too. And you forget it. A friend of mine was telling me, can we see the future lottery numbers that are going to come up tomorrow in the astral plane? I said, yes, you can. He said, that'll be a great idea. Let's go meditate, go to the astral plane and see the ticket number that's coming out tomorrow. Come back, buy the ticket, put those numbers in and win millions of dollars. I said, it doesn't work like that. Because by the time you come back and this reality comes back, you go back to square one, just try to remember what numbers were there. Sometimes you can remember a few numbers. Some people tried this. They needed five or six numbers, they remembered two correctly. The rest were wrong. So they got nothing. So why is that? How can you have a higher experience? An experience when it is happening, you know it's higher than the wakeful experience. You're sure it's a higher experience. It's an astral experience. You know it. You can see future. You can see things that you cannot see here. And yet when you come here, that fades away. Because we accept this reality. We move from one reality to another reality. And that's why this reality comes up, everything else becomes unreal. This happens at every level of consciousness. It happens when you go to the causal plane. Astral and physical and dream all become dreamlike. And that is the reality. You can see the whole of destiny, how it was made. Everything comes to your knowledge. You are amazed by it. But when you come back to this reality, it remains a small memory. Did I dream or did I really go there? These kind of questions come up. Because they're accepting this wakeful reality at that time as the only reality. There we accepted that as the only reality. So this whole business of creating levels of reality through levels of consciousness is not a creation of illusions. It's a creation of what we think is reality. Of course, in every area of these three regions, it's the perception that creates that reality. And perception alters from one region to another. But when you reach totality of consciousness, you see the whole show, and the whole show is taking place right there, including the entire creation of all regions. Thereafter, you are in all regions at all times. And therefore, that experience is never forgotten. Therefore, if you want to have a permanent experience of always living in your true home and living here and living elsewhere, you must go to totality of consciousness, where the merger takes place completely. Everything that exists merges into this along with you. It's not that you go into merger and some people are left behind. There's nobody left behind. There is nobody. It's created like dreams. So that is why that merger is the goal which great perfect living masters set for us. And they say this can be achieved in a human life. How can you achieve something so dramatic, so real, so surreal, so beyond imagination? How can you achieve that when you are in such a lower level of creation of the sixth level of dreaming in the physical state? How has it been arranged in such a way? It's arranged in a very strange way. And the strange way is that the human body in which we live, which we think is ourself at this time, the human body itself has lots of things which we can't see physiologically or by anatomy, we cannot see them. But they are there. Those are centers of energy and centers of awareness. They can't be seen, but we know where they are. Those centers of energy which lie below the eyes, and the centers of awareness which lie in a short space within the head above, those centers exist as invisible centers in the body, which can be captured and their experience obtained by putting attention, which is in any case coming from the soul, which is in any case coming from our true home. By putting your attention in those centers, you're able to have a glimpse of what happens when you are there. It does not mean that when you have that human experience of a higher level of consciousness, that you are dead here, that you really died and you've gone there. You experience death. You experience identical experience like death without dying. The body is intact. The vital forces are working the same way. This body remains intact. And within this body, by putting attention on the center, you are able to have awakened those experiences. That's the most remarkable miracle, that this body should contain all that. And the only thing required is already gifted to all of us. The gift of human attention, the gift of human imagination, the gift of being able to concentrate that attention. Three things only. These three are only needed for making all progress on the spiritual path. The use of your attention, the use of the power to concentrate that attention, and the use of imagination to see where you want to put your attention on. It's so simple. It's been made simple. If we are true seekers of the reality of all creation, we can follow the simple rule of discovering it within ourselves, because it all lies within ourselves. Every level of so-called creation outside is being created from those levels. It's very difficult to explain. When we take one level as a reality, it's very difficult to explain. It's not real. We were driving here to this meeting, and Dwight was driving me, and he was asking me the same questions which we have been asking and answering for years, for many people. When we are together so many, who is dreaming? Are we all dreaming? Is it collective dreaming? The question was asked yesterday also. Is it collective dreaming? I said, no. Supposing we go into a dream and meet 20 people, who is dreaming? Do you know who is dreaming out of those 20 people? None of those people. But the one who wakes up and finds that there were 20 created by that person. When do you find that was a dream? When you wake up, not while you're dreaming. The difficulty is we think this body of ours is real, we are real, the rest is a dream. That's not true. Your body is as much of a dream as anybody else's. So therefore, if you are in a dream state, you can talk real things. You can talk about reality. But you don't know it. The knowing only comes when you wake up. When you wake up, you know who was the dreamer. The one who was sleeping. Not everybody that you saw in the dream. This is like a dream. But it is not a dream. It will only become a dream when you wake up to the astral plane. It will look like a dream. Then what about the millions of people here? They will all disappear. Who will come up? The people who live alive in the astral plane. They may not be the same people. Some of them may be the same copies. Some of them may not be. Then you rise further. Though everything becomes dream. You awake to higher. If you keep on waking up, what happens at the end? You find there was only one dreamer. Totality of consciousness. Everything was created from that one dreamer. One power of consciousness, which created through power of consciousness all kinds of experiences and all these dreams or realities. So it's such a marvelous setup. Have one trip to totality of consciousness. Then I will give you a homework to do. And that is change the destiny of everything and make a new world. You will not be able to change it. I got this challenge from Great Master once. He said, I'll show you how this is created. Now you say, I can remove illness from here, I can remove wars from here, I can remove suffering, I'll close down all the hospitals, I'll close all weapon-making machinery, I'll do this, make a very peaceful place. Okay, try it. Try from the grand picture of creation. See how each is balanced in duality, in the principle of duality. See how this has been created. And when you look at that, then you find that there is nothing, it's all so perfectly placed. You can only see that when you see the full picture, total picture. So, absolutely you as a human being change completely if you have reached that goal. That goal gives you an experience nothing else can give. Because it gives you experience of all levels, equally real, equally unreal at the same time. That's a wonderful goal, and that's what these perfect living masters promise. That's what meditation can give us. Meditation is the first step. We will do meditation again today. We'll do meditation advancing from what we did yesterday. And tomorrow we'll go even further and see how many of us can make progress during this short period. But there is a possibility that you could make a lot of progress. If you follow up what we do here, when you go back where you are staying, even at night, you will make more progress. And when you go away from this meditation workshop and you go home and you follow up and practice it, you gain even more. So that's why use this only as a sampling of what one can get and follow it up later on. Later in the afternoon, I will be able to take you a few steps further from what we did yesterday. And then we'll move on again. I would like to now take up some questions and answers if Jonathan has some. He says he has lots of them. So we'll see how many we can cover.
Could we please hear a song before questions?
Okay, that's good. Maybe the song will answer some questions. Are you going to sing?
I won't sing. We don't want to punish everyone. But if you all will open your ears and your hearts for an original song that will be performed by Dana Edelman. Give him a minute to get ready, and thank you.
Every time I look into your eyes, I see a billion stars. You feel like I could fly. When you say to meet you by the door, you'll be awaiting there with the love that I adore. One that's unconditional and strong. Take me home, be loved by your grace alone. Drawn by your love, take me home. Take me home, me love you, by your grace alone. Drawn by your love, take me home. How I felt the yearning since my birth that could not be satisfied. Riches of this earth. Then you heard me crying out for something more. Oh, Master, there you found me. Shook me to the core. Now we go together, never alone. Take me home, beloved, by your grace alone. Drawn by your love.
Thank you very much. Lovely song. Answered many questions. Are there any more questions?
If a prospective disciple is already initiated by another spiritual master, but seeks initiation from you, does the initiation erase the effect of the previous master, or does it still remain in effect, but now the disciple has two masters to greet him within and focus on either one?
If a prospective disciple is already initiated by another spiritual master but seeks initiation from you, does the initiation erase the effort of the previous master, or does it still remain effective but now the disciple has two masters to create within and who can focus on either one? Let me tell you, who is a master? A master is merely a human form of our true form, which we can find inside us and the human body as a form of sound, the word. The word, the sound, is the master. It can manifest in any form. It manifests in human form because that's the most convenient form for a seeker to get guidance to go to his true home. Therefore, in truth, All spiritual masters are one. They come from the same source and they are one master. So you don't really shift from one master to another. It only happens that you may have made some progress with one master and have been limited to that point for any reason, including the fact that the master may have reached that limit also. Or you have reached that limit, but the master has not. And subsequently, you want personal guidance and don't get it, and you get another master. It does not mean you have two masters. Even when a master, perfect living master, initiates us, and we have not made enough progress, and we go to the next life, we have another master. It does not mean we have two masters. Because the master power is only one. And that manifests in no matter which master it is. And that's why when you say, if one has been initiated by a master, there should be some reason, some personal reason for going to another master. One reason is inevitable when you do not find the next master in the same life, but you find next life. Then automatically, you get another master. But the master power of the word or the shabd is still the same. It never changes. So do not think that you can ever have two masters. There's only one master. But the forms can be different. And do not think the form is the master. The form is merely conveying the master power of the single master who comes, who's carrying the power of such kind of the truth right from totality and not from anywhere here. So that is why if one feels that one has not been able to make enough progress with one master, especially the master has passed away in his physical form and takes another master, it does not mean you have got two masters. Even if masters are alive and you feel that you don't have access to one, you can have access to another, still there is a reason. There of course has to be a reason to go to another master. Otherwise, if a master has initiated you and given you the initiation and tells you the method of meditation, follow it. Manifest that master inside. And follow the master inside. And he'll take you back home. But if you have a problem in this process and you feel you need, then only you can seek initiation from another perfect living master. And that is how the system works. So far as initiation by me is concerned, I don't initiate. You must know that every initiation that takes place with me is a kind of initiation by my master. I get specific approval in each case in front of you. And you have seen me do that. That I get the approval, great master, that now you can be a vehicle to give the same message that a master can give. So I function only as a servant of the great master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh. And therefore, my initiation has always been called the great master's initiation. And in all the communications Mark sends out, he says, great master's initiation is granted with these following preparatory things that you can do, be vegetarian, give up smoking, give up drinks, give up this thing. He gives some guidelines. But the initiation is by one master, because there is only one master. And that master is the power from such kind and can manifest in anybody. Okay?
Master, how do we go past the world struggles that mind wants to think and worry about?
How do we get past the world struggles that mind wants to think and worry about? Meditation. Putting your attention away from the world's worries. That's all what meditation is about. That we try to put our attention elsewhere than where the worries are. It always doesn't work. The worries seem to take precedence and we keep on worrying. The common sense says that we should not worry. You know why? Because worry has never solved anybody's problems. We worry too much. We worry about things which don't even happen. This might happen, therefore I'm worried. And that never happens. But we worried anyway. So we worry too much. The real worry disappears. Actual worrying by the mind disappears when we experience the unconditioned love of a master to the extent that we are willing to surrender all decision making to the master and not worried about anything. When that happens, there is no worry left. That's the ultimate cure for worry. That when you have this kind of faith built up with the love and devotion that you experience with the master, that you are able to surrender everything. Decision making, master, leave it to you. I want to have a deal with you. The deal is, I give you worries, you give me all the joys going to such kind. You get that deal, how can there be any worry? And by the way, that deal is open to all of you. And in that deal, the master has no problem. He can fulfill his part very easily. We have a problem that we say, master, we won't worry, you take the worry, next day we start worrying. Our part is difficult, not master's. Master's part is very easy. He will take care of everything because he is the power that creates the experiences that we are having. So he can take care of everything. But we are the one who worry in spite of the deal. So the deal fails on our part, not on the part of the master. So the real answer to this question, how can we bypass the worries and problems of the mind, is to hand over decision making in your life to master instead of mind. Not mind, but master. Then you go to that state, worry disappears.
Do you have time to tell the story about the Barupiya?
Do you have time to tell the story about the Barupiya? They want to confess about my going to the prostitute's lane? Okay, I don't mind. I'll tell it anyway. There are entertainers in India, we call them Barupiyas. Barupiya means to change their roop, that we change their form, they disguise themselves. They wear different disguises, costumes, to look different than they are. And then they go in households and they appear to be the disguised person, not who they really are, and then they get some money for their entertainment. Sometimes a police officer will come to our house and say, there's a charge against you. And you say, oh, what is it? Well, 50 bucks. What for? Because I'm not a policeman. You thought I was a policeman. The fee is 50 bucks for not recognizing a Barupiya. If you say, you are not a policeman, then only 5 bucks for his makeup. So this was very common at one time. And I remember that we used to have this experience in Hoshiarpur, where my father was teaching and I was a student in the college there, that these Barupiyas used to come, disguised sometimes like sadhus in saffron colored robes, going to the mountains. We are going up to the Himalayas now. We want some alms. Oh, we'll give you some, 50 bucks at least. Oh, we do. We have not recognized them. So that was a rate they had fixed up, 50 or 5. If we identify them, 5, otherwise 50. So once my dad and I, we were walking and we had to go to a Hakim, a Yunani physician for some medicine. He lived beyond the red light area of the town where the prostitutes lived. And both of us, we were walking and suddenly a woman jumps out and catches hold of my arm. I was a young man at that time. And my dad is with me. And she catches her, oh, I'm very happy to see you again. I said, Dad, I have never seen this woman before. How dare you say that? I proved you, I saw you. You came to, and I saw you. Oh, I was so ashamed. I said, such a lie, and I am being caught, and Dad keeps on believing that woman. He says, no, in young age, these things can happen. I said, no, nothing happened. But he keeps on thinking like that. I feel so bad. Next day, a police inspector comes and says something. He says, 50 bucks. I said, no, you are not a police inspector. No, this is for yesterday. That's the Barupiya story. Why is it told? Masters tell this story because perfectly living masters are Barupiyas. They come disguised. They come as ordinary people, but don't think they're ordinary. They come as totally ordinary people, that's a disguise they put on. And inside, they are something very different from what you look at. They are Barupiyas.
When and how to get grace from Master. That is, how to ask.
When and how to get grace from Master, that is, how to ask, Master, give me grace. Simple. The way you would ask anybody else, the way you would ask for anything else. The only difference is that instead of asking out in the air, ask inside at the third eye center. When you are initiated by a master, he puts himself in your third eye center. And he's there always. You may see him or not see him. You don't see so many things that are there. You don't see Sajkhand there. You don't see anything there. So you don't see the master there. It takes a while to have enough attention gathered there to be able to see the master. But he's there. So when you want to ask for grace, you want to ask for help, you want to complain, you want to praise, you want to thank, do it right there. The right place for communication with the master is behind the eyes where we meditated yesterday, we'll meditate today. That's the place to ask for grace.
Does voting create karma?
Every action where you take a decision with your free choice creates karma. If you vote by making a choice, you create karma. We create karma all the time by making choices in our head. This is just one of the minor karmas. So one should not be too frightened by karma voting. So then we make many other karmas which are much worse.
Master, if everything, spiritual progress, is in hands of the Master, then why should we meditate? What should we do?
If everything, the spiritual progress is in the hands of the Master, then why should we meditate? You don't need to. If you accept the first part, if you accept that everything is in the hands of the Master, you don't have to meditate. That's enough meditation. If we can leave everything to the Master and believe he's doing everything, that's a very successful portion of meditation. Meditation alone leads us to that. And if somebody already has it, meditation is merely a method, a device. It's not the end. It's means to an end. But being able to recognize that everything is in the hands of the Master is a recognition of close to the end. It is not a means. So that is why, if you know that everything is in the hands of the Master, you don't need to meditate. If your love and devotion for the Master is so strong, it has created an unshakable faith, no meditation is necessary. It is not meditation that will take us. It is the building up of faith inside, a knowledge of the Master, knowing that the Master is within, and awareness of the Master, actual awareness of having a communication with the Master at all times, knowing the presence of the Master who is taking care of everything. That's what is the real secret of going further on spiritual progress. Meditation is just a means to reach that end. So that is why, if you can qualify for the first part, that everything is in the hands of the Master, you don't need to meditate.
Dear Ishwar Ji, what is the importance of kirtans on a spiritual path? Why don't we have kirtans in Isha meetings?
What is the importance of kirtans on the spiritual path? Why don't we have kirtans in Isha meetings? We just had a kirtan. Yes. You heard that song? Kirtan is a song. Kirtan is singing. Kirtan means singing. Chanting and singing is kirtan. It is done in one religious group. They always have these kirtans. They sing songs. Other religions also sing hymns. We all sing. We all like to sing. We all like to hear music. It's innate in us to hear music because our own self is musical. Our own self can be heard as music inside us. Our very substance, our very nature, our essence is music. Therefore, we can create a music outside and feel a resonance to it. The resonance that comes by listening to music is the resonance of our own inner music. But the outer music cannot take us within. We cannot. Some people tell me, Master, it is so difficult to keep on repeating the Simran that my mind flops away. But I have a good device now. I have a tape recorder it. So I just put it near my head. It keeps on doing the Simran all the time. I said, you are very good at concentrating your attention on the tape recorder. Obviously. Kirtan, in fact, is supposed to be listening to the music within. In Guru Granth Sahib, it says, Kal Yug mein Kirtan Pradhana. In Kal Yug, Kirtan will be the real way to go. And there they're taking the Kirtan is outside singing. He's referring continuously to the sound within, to the music within. True Kirtan is listening to the sound within.
Dear Master, your beautiful explanations satisfy the mind and enable it to move forward as a helpful companion. Now it wants to understand how the Master is able to neutralize the sentient karma storehouse. How is the law, how is the karmic law satisfied? Does the Master pay the debts himself?
Your beautiful explanations satisfy the mind and enable it to move forward as a helpful companion. Now it wants to understand how the Master is able to neutralize the Sitchit Karma storehouse. How is the karmic law satisfied? Does the Master pay the debts himself? The two parts of this question. One is related to initiation. And one is related to paying debts of our karma here. When the Master initiates, he is initiating a person to connect him to his reality, his soul. Soul has no karma at all. Nobody's soul has any karma at all. Karma is only on the mind. Mind creates karma, mind bears karma, mind pays karma, mind does everything on karma. Karma is a mental thing. The soul is above the mind and is not involved in this. It suffers the consequence of karma by identifying with the mind and identifying with what the mind creates, including this body. When the mind creates sense perceptions and the body, then the soul identifies with it. Our consciousness identifies this is the self, and we pay the karma. If you disidentify now, remove this identification, there will be no karma at all. Soul has no karma. What the Masters do at the time of initiation is a spiritual thing that they do by which they connect you to the spirit and take you away from the dependence on the mind for karma. And that's why all past karma, the sinchit karma, is broken away, dissolved immediately. It's not a special capability that a Master uses to do this. It's just lifting you up from the realm of the karma. But since you are still in a body, still with the mind, still with the sense perceptions, still living a life in the human body, and this will not survive without a karma, the Master allows only the prarabdha, the destiny of this life to go on. The rest is finished. This life's karma goes on. And during that life karma, the Master can do something like paying off your debt. That means instead of you getting sick seriously, he can get sick mildly. If into you getting into a big accident, he can get hurt a little bit. Master do that as part of the prarabdha going on. But sinchit is totally removed at the time of initiation as a spiritual gift to us at the time of initiation.
Is desire a hindrance on the spiritual path? How do we avoid it or choose the right ones?
Is desire a hindrance on the spiritual path? How do we avoid it or choose the right ones? Desire is a natural function of the mind. When we are novices on the spiritual path, we are using the mind to understand. We are trying to absorb the knowledge of the spiritual path, the structure of how it works, which the mind understands. Therefore, the mind gets satisfied by desire for knowledge. Mind has also a lot of other desires. It has so many desires. The desires by themselves are not bad. To desire a thing is not bad, but to attach yourself to the desire can be disastrous. When you desire something and attach yourself to that, then the attachment brings you back again and again, not the desire. So it's the attachment part That is really a problem for us. So desires can be switched from one to the other. You go to, giving an example for young people who like to follow women. A man goes, says, such a woman has come, I never saw one, and falls in love. A more beautiful one comes. He says, what was I doing with that ugly woman? What happened to his desire for that ugly woman? It changed, switched over. Okay, I'm eating my food. Well, that's all I could get. Better food comes. Oh, my desire switches. This is better. Desire is such a switchable process that we switch from one desire to another. And because desires can be switched, we can also desire to go within. We can also desire to make progress on the spiritual path. We can also desire to go to a meeting with the master. We can desire all those desires. So we can always switch our desires to something more desirable. And that is why desire itself is not a problem. The attachments are the problem.
Do aliens visit you to see you or attend your discourses? Is there any alien here today present?
Do aliens visit you to see you or attend your discourses? Is there any alien here today present in this satsang? It depends on what you define as an alien. If by alien you define a disembodied spirit, which means that there was a person in a human form and died, but his attachments are still here, then the disembodied form of that person will hover around till another housing, another body can be found. Such disembodied spirits do roam around. They are astral forms of the physical form that died. The astral form is always retained. It's much longer life than a physical form. The physical form of a human being is very limited. What, 100 years, 80 years? 110, 20, nobody lived even 200. It's a very short period. Out of billions of years, we think this world is in existence. So that is why. But the spirit form, which is the astral form, which is the disembodied form of a spirit or a holy, or a what we call a ghost. You know, the spirits we call ghosts also. I read a cartoon here on a wine shop. It's written, spirit sold here. And all the ghosts are running away from there. The ghosts are merely disembodied spirits who move around. And there are lots of them. Always there are lots of them, because lots of them die and are attached to people, attached to places, and they roam around here. They roam around for a certain period, after which they go and get embodied somewhere else. So those ghosts, which are not visible to us because they don't have a physical body, they roam around. Sometimes they come to our meetings also. I remember one lady, she was in the hospital on a terminal illness and was dying. She wanted to die quickly. I said, no, just a little bit more. If you pay off your karma, you won't have to come back again. But she said, I want to attend the bandara. And this was happening 2 or 3 days before the bandara. Doctors won't let me go, get out of here. I said, don't worry, you will attend the bandara. She died on 1st April, was at bandara on 2nd April. And sitting next to me, there were another two who died long ago, were also sitting there. One man was murdered, he was at the back. So these people do come and attend these meetings, but you can't see them. Some people can see them also. Some people with a lot of sensitivity to these astral experiences, who have already practiced energetic out-of-body experiences, sometimes they can see, but many can feel them. These disembodied spirits want to be felt because they feel they are missing something. They have left the body, and instead of enjoying their status where they can fly, they can go anywhere, they are so attached that they feel that they have to go back to where they were. In the case of unnatural death, like suicide or murder, there is in the karmic pattern a certain portion called a notional life. That means a life is set and you will live up to age 80. At age 40, you commit suicide. And those 40 years of life are still destined for that being and are spent in a disembodied state. And there are two types of disembodied spirits that stay after death. One, those who stay at the place where the death took place because of attachments there. And those who were running for some things and they couldn't find it and they're still running around. In India, we call them by two different names. These ghosts are divided. One are called Bhoot. Bhoot is the one who roams around everywhere. Roams around all over looking for something that he couldn't find here. And Pret, Bhoot and Pret. Pret are those who are stuck at one place. And they created what is called a haunted house atmosphere, a haunted place atmosphere. And people feel they have a presence. They try to make their presence. So if by aliens you mean disembodied spirits, yes, they roam around. And they do come sometimes. Especially those who have people they are attached to. The attached people want to come to me, they come, we'll follow. So now you must know who are the people attached to you who have died. And you can look around and they might be here. But if by aliens you mean people who are living in other planets or coming from some other else place in the galaxies, they exist also. They exist and they are trying to contact other galaxies because they are more advanced than us in technologies and so on. And they have understood the nature of time and space better than we have. So they are also trying to do these things and trying to make contacts. But those are rare. Those don't happen every day. Disembodied spirits as aliens, if you call them aliens, are more common.
Do we bear karmic responsibility for unwanted, intrusive thoughts which are dismissed as soon as they are recognized as such? I call these anger lust attacks.
Do we have karmic responsibility for unwanted, intrusive thoughts which are dismissed as soon as they recognize as such? I call these anger lust attacks. We have defined five actions of a human being as vices. And they are lust, anger, greed, possessiveness, and ego. These five have been called vices. Not fair to call them vices because we need all five of them to pay off our karma. So how can we call them vices when they are so necessary? They are necessary to pay off our karma and they are bad because they stop our spiritual growth. So therefore, they are double-edged swords. That they are used by us to pay off karma and also used to create karma. And then they stand in the way of our spiritual progress. These do not go away very easily. Even while you are making spiritual progress, they will still attack. They are still there because you still have karma left to go on through this life. They can be weakened to some extent through meditation, through pulling your attention away from them, by practicing some kind of restraint upon these things, by trying to hide them to some extent. You can do a lot of things to minimize their effect and to not let them become the source of more karma, more dramatic or bad karma, but they still be there. The only time when they really disappear from your life is when you cross the Trikuti, the top of the causal plane, the universal mind, and go into the Parabrahm area of pure soul, there are no such vices at all left. In fact, in a dramatic scene, they show how the soul is going on like a crow flying, and then there is a pool of nectar called Amritsar, a big nectar, Mansarovar. Those pools are there which transform you because you are leaving the mind behind. You go, come out like swans, and that's just a story. But it means that big transformation takes place in us. And so far as these five are concerned, they become instrument of use as needed only after you cross that in order to make use of them for the remaining part of our karma. But they do not disappear even when you're making progress, even if you have radiant form of the master within, even if you have traveled into inner regions, they get minimized, but they're still there. They're part of our nature to pay off, create and pay off karma.
Sweet Master, do the six layers of consciousness correspond to the 12 dimensions of higher, faster frequencies that get faster the closer you get towards the divine oneness of God? If so, how does it work?
Do the six layers of consciousness correspond to the 12 dimensions of higher, faster frequencies that get faster the closer you get towards the divine oneness? God, if so, how does it work? The word frequency is a word confined to the experience of time and space. There is no frequency beyond that. Therefore, there is no frequency beyond the mind. We cannot appropriately use the word frequency for describing a spiritual experience which is beyond the mind. But we can use the word frequency for all other experiences, because other experiences taking place in space and time are dependent upon the frequencies of the electromagnetic vibrations, other energy factors that are working in this area. So the frequency concept does not lead us to the divinity or the divine oneness that we are talking of. Frequency ends where the mind ends, and something else starts for which we have not found any word, except the word, word. We can't find any other word. The word, the shabd, the sound current. That's the oneness, and that's not a frequency. This sound is frequency, which we hear here, but that's not. It's not a frequency sound. It's a creative power, creative awareness that expands to totality. So that is why when we talk of the 12 dimensions of the higher frequencies, they take us to the level of universal consciousness and not anymore. Divinity lies beyond that.
What is the meaning of experience? Does the principle of experience go beyond the mind?
What is the meaning of experience? Does the principle experience go beyond the mind? Experience is only in time and space again, like frequencies. It does not go beyond the mind. You cannot use any word for something beyond the mind. I have tried to use a word with some guilt and hesitancy. I have tried to say states of awareness. But that's even not completely real, because there are no states. It's pure awareness, it's pure consciousness. But experience is that which can be experienced and is always in time. You don't have a timeless experience. The word experience ends when something is timeless. And everything beyond the mind is timeless and has no time and no space in it. It's a totally different kind of experience of consciousness. And that is why experience is limited to what can happen in time. Therefore, it's limited to mental, astral and physical experiences, mental, sensory and physical material experiences. That's where experience ends.
When a disciple is initiated and incurs future karma by breaking one of the vows, like not yet or not always following a moral life, and yet is helpless to do so and is repentant but still carries on despite wishing it to end, are they still punished or is it forgiven by Master?
When a disciple is initiated and incurs future karma by breaking one of the vows, like not yet always following a moral life and yet is helpless to do so and is repentant but still carries on despite wishing it to end, are they still punished or is it forgiven by Master? Masters always forgive. Period. I've never seen a perfect living master punishing anybody. I often tell the story, true story, of a man coming to great master, and he's reading the mail, and we are all sitting around the master, and a man comes running. He says, "Master, forgive me. You told me not to drink alcohol. Last night I drank so much alcohol. You told me not to do this, not eat meat. I ate steaks, I ate everything last night. You told me not to do immoral things. I was womanizing all night. I was in bad company all night. Please forgive me." Master said, okay, you're forgiven. Go. He said, thank you, and he ran away. He said, Master said, don't do it again. You're forgiven, don't do it again. He ran away. All his secretaries sitting there, Master's close friend sitting there, were surprised. They said, Master, how can you forgive a guy like this? He broke all your vows. Didn't you see that this man just comes to you and says, forgive me, and you say, forgiven? Master said, what else could I do? He has asked for forgiveness, I forgave him. They said, Master, but what happens if he does the same things again and comes to you and says, forgive me, will you forgive him again? Master said, I think I'll forgive him again. Master, when will you punish him? He said, keep me on the sides of forgivers and not punishers. This man's mind has punished him more than I could have done. His own mind has punished him when he came to me. The punisher is sitting inside our head, who with guilt punishes us all the time. And masters always forgive. Isn't the punishment that the mind gives and holds guilt for lifetime sometimes enough punishment? The mind is a great punisher. Time is a great punisher. Kaal is a great punisher. Why bring masters into this category? Masters are always forgivers. Our mind punishes us enough.
Dear Master Ishwar, if a person was initiated by a PLM who has since passed away, and if that person only saw the PLM at a distance two or three times, should this person seek initiation from the present PLM? Thank you for everything.
If a person was initiated by a PLM who has since passed away, I believe it's a reference to PLM, or it's a reference to the person, PLM. If a person was initiated by a PLM who has since passed away, and if that person only saw the PLM at a distance two or three times, should that person seek initiation from a present PLM? I have to take a sip of water for this question. There is a thing called darshan, which means looking at the face of a master, of a perfect living master. A perfect living master's face reflects the face of a being, a human being, in whom the conscious has reached its totality, not at some point, at all times. Having a darshan of such a person guarantees that one day you'll be initiated by a PLM. Imagine how many people get this opportunity, especially in this age, and they're all guaranteed to find a PLM one day. Not necessarily this life, not perhaps the next. When they're seeking, which you start from that point onwards, builds up to a point where they go and seek initiation by a perfect living master who appears in their life at the right time. This is called darshan, the power of darshan. And then there is drishti. Drishti is when you are looking at a master, he also looks at you with his eyes meeting your eyes. That drishti is more powerful and guarantees that you will be initiated by a perfect living master within the next four lives. If you are already initiated by a person who the master has passed away and whom you have just seen, you are guaranteed initiation in one of these four lives, because the master has looked at you, given you drishti. These are very powerful things, darshan and drishti. There used to be a story told about Narad Muni. Narad was one of the munis. Muni is one of the levels of development as a yogi. There is a yogi, then the rishi, then there's a muni, then there's a yogeshwar. So they have categorized people how far developed they were in their spiritual life. So there was a muni, very famous muni. There are a lot of stories about him. His name is Narad Muni. And most Indians know about Narad Muni. He used to go around telling stories about his contact with the gods, Brahma, Vishnu. And he had inner contact with Brahma, the creator of the universe. So one day, when he was walking out, he used to go from village to village, talking to people. They would give him some alms, then he would preach something. Sometimes he would tell stories. Sometimes he would create problems between people. Tell one story to one family, another opposite story to another family, and they would fight after he left. So sometime today also a man who does this is called Narad Muni. That means he is creating problems between families. So Narad Muni was once walking and he saw a crowd of people running. He asked them, "Where are you running?" They say, "A Sadguru, a perfect master has come. We are going for his darshan. We just want to have a look at him." He says, "What's the value? You don't meditate, you don't do any yoga, and you are running after seeing a person. How does it help you?" They said, no, we have no time for you. We are going for darshan." And they ran. So Narad Muni was a little surprised that what kind of man would be that running people are running just to look at him. So he decided to investigate at the source from Brahma himself. So he went into meditation and contacted Brahma. And Brahmaji, "I saw these people running for what they call darshan. They just want to look at a man, and what does it do to them?" And Brahmaji said, "Oh, that's a good question. You go into that village, and there is a pond there. In the pond, there is a snake. And the snake has got his head up from the water. Go and ask that snake, and he will give you the answer." So Narad Muni followed the instructions of Brahmaji, which he found in meditation, and he went to that village, found a pond and a snake there. So he talks to the snake. He said, "Mr. Snake," I'm just translating. He said, "Mr. Snake, what is the advantage of having darshan of a guru and people run after him?" The snake saw him and chopped his head and died. He said, "This snake could not give my answer. This is strange that Brahmaji should send me to this snake." So he goes back to Brahmaji in meditation. He says, "Brahmaji, you told me go to the snake and he'll give you the answer. I went to the snake. He dropped his head and died." Brahmaji says, "Oh, I'm so sorry to hear that. The snake died. Okay, now you go to a further village. And there is a jeweler living there. And he has a parrot in a cage. And you travel there and find and talk to the parrot. He'll give you the answer." So Narad Muni again started on his journey and eventually reached that village and saw there was a jeweler there, went to his house. "Do you have a parrot?" "Yeah, I have a new parrot. I just got a new parrot. It's right in the cage." So goes to the parrot and he says, "Mr. Parrot, tell me, what is the benefit and advantage of looking at a master's face? What's the advantage of a darshan?" The parrot dropped his head and died. He said, "This is very funny. I go to these people on the instruction of Brahmaji and the snake died, parrot has died." So he went back to Brahmaji in meditation. He says, "What is this going on? You send me to the snake, I ask this question, the snake dies. You send me to a parrot and the parrot dies. Oh, they're both dead, sorry. Now you go to another kingdom. It will take you a while to travel, but go there. The queen of that kingdom has just given birth to a baby boy. By the time you reach, there will be a baby boy there. Infant. Ask that infant this very question." Now he said parrot and snake were all right. But not the infant. But he had to carry out the orders of the Brahmaji, the creator. So he traveled all the way. After months and months, he reached there. When he reached there, the kingdom, he sent a message that Narad Muni is here. The king welcomed him. "Such after a long time we have met you, Narad Muni ji. Most welcome. We are honored to have you in our palace." He says, "I have come for a very special purpose. Has the queen given birth to a baby boy?" "Yes, she has. Just delivered a baby boy. I want to see that baby boy." "Narad Muni ji, so blessed is this baby boy that you have come to give him your darshan." He said, quivering inside, "I don't know what kind of darshan is going to be." But he said, "I want to see this baby boy alone." He said, "Certainly." So he went and there was a little infant lying there. And he says, "Mr. Infant, what is the benefit of having a darshan of these gurus. They come and people run after these gurus to have a darshan, just look at them. And the infant spoke. And he said, Narad Muni, I am the same parrot that you saw in the cage. And I am the same snake that you saw. You are not a perfect master. You are just a Muni. But just by seeing you, you are having your darshan, I immediately ended my life as a snake and improved to a life of a parrot. Seeing you second time, I got a human birth. It's just by having your darshan. When you have a darshan of a perfect living master, the reward is 1,000 times more. That's how Narad Muni got the answer to what is the benefit of a darshan. So that is why. This is just a story. But the story helps us to understand what happens when we have a darshan. And when you are seeing a master on whose list A you are, something happens instantly to you. That as if you are waiting for this. As if all your life you are waiting for this. The mind tries to throw that doubt away, but still comes up. Then the thought doesn't come, a feeling comes deep inside. A spiritual feeling, a feeling in the soul. This is it. This is it. And you can't help having that feeling. List A. Such is the value of a darshan, of a perfect living master. A few more.
What is the concept of devas and asuras, and how does it relate to human life?
What is the concept of devas and asuras, and how does it relate to human life? Devas and asuras are Indian words for angels, different kinds of angels. And these angels are sitting there because of their karma, they became angels. They're sitting in the astral plane. And because of their relationship with some of the people who are still in their physical bodies, they affect them. They affect them internally. And they relate to the internal astral self of the physical bodies here. And they sometimes they are good influences, sometimes they are not. Some of these devas are very good influences. Asuras can be negative. And these are just ways of saying there are positive angels and negative angels. And they are guardian angels. Guardian angels are those angels that are in that state, but they have a link with us and they want to take care of us. And we get a feeling that we have somebody taking care, even when we don't have a master. When a perfect living master comes into our life, all these are replaced by the perfect living master. Now, guardian angels are also angels, but there is one guardian angel who is in a physical body and he is sitting somewhere. He is my guardian angel. His name is Hugh McCaffrey. And if you know how he became guardian angel, ask him at lunchtime.
If a family member is deliberately hurting you, is it okay to cut them out of your life? What are the karmic implications of doing this?
If a family member is deliberately hurting you, is it okay to cut them out of your life? What are the karmic implications of doing this? A family member hurts you when you hurt that family member in a past life. Nobody hurts you just for the sake of hurting you. It's a karmic payout. We are hurting people, we get hurt by people. We are rewarding people, we get rewarded by people. That's the karmic pattern. The karmic pattern is settling accounts one way or the other. Giving, taking, giving, taking. So that is why when somebody is hurting us, if we are on the spiritual path and we don't want to extend the karma further, because mostly we extend the karma further. He's hurting me, I'll hurt you. And then it goes on, then he hurts me again. Then I hurt him again. It goes on forever. If you want to stop it, hurting you, forgive him, end it. There the cycle ends. That is why they say forgiveness is so important on the spiritual path. Forgive everybody. Forgive everyone. Don't think of punishing. Don't think of doing something. Now this is one part of the answer. Second part, to the second part of the question, should we then avoid them? Sure, avoid them. If something is negative somewhere, something is not desirable, you should avoid. There are three ways of avoiding. If somebody is speaking, then don't speak. That's avoiding. If somebody is speaking too much, close your ears. That's also avoiding. Finally, if somebody is speaking, you want to avoid, run away. There was a holy man who came to Chicago the other day. I told this story the other day, I think, to somebody, that he was asked by a housewife in Chicago. The holy man was sitting. He said, "Holy man, I have a big problem. I and my husband quarrel all the time. We are fighting all the time. We want to have peace in the house. Can you give some blessing? Can you do some solution for this? Always constantly fighting over the petty things, we just argue all the time." He said, "Yes, I have a solution for you. Go and bring a bottle of water, I'll bless it." So the woman goes and brings a bottle of water, and the holy man blesses, says a mantra on the bottle. He says, "Now take it." He says, "How often should I give it to my husband?" "It's not for the husband, it's for you. And I'll tell you how to use it. When the husband starts speaking, open this bottle and take a sip and hold it in your mouth. Don't swallow it till the husband stops speaking. When he stops, you swallow. If he starts speaking again, take another sip. There'll be peace in the house." It's a very nice, dramatic way of saying that you should avoid these situations, which you can. No argument goes on with both not arguing. If one stops arguing, the argument ends there. But we react with anger. We react with our own emotional reaction to what is happening. And we act the same way like the other person is reacting, with no difference. And that is why the karmic pattern continues. So it's best to forgive and end things there. And the best way is to recognize that somebody just hurt, we just paid off a bill of ours, and old debt has been cleared. And we can say, "Thank you. I have said thank you to my wife all my life."
Do so-called lower animals, dogs, cats, insects, also choose their DED before their earthly sojourn?
Do so-called lower animals, dogs, cats, insects also choose their DVD before their earthly sojourn? No. The DVD is only chosen by a mind which is going to manifest as a human being. The mind chooses the DVD, becomes a human being, carrying with it past lives, which can be in many forms, including dogs and cats and insects. It carries future lives, which can be based upon the karma of one single life which has been chosen. It creates the lives of all forms of life, ahead and behind. And that is why the past lives can be of these. And if the future actions of that one particular life you've chosen leads to the life of a cat or a dog, you will become a cat or a dog. But not that you were a cat and dog and made a selection. The selection is made at the mental level, at the causal level, and you become a human being to start with.
In today's hyper-competitive dog-eat-dog world, how can we be spiritual and be successful in our jobs? I find people cheat and lie to get a promotion. What should we do?
In today's hyper-competitive dog-eat-dog world, how can we be spiritual and be successful in our jobs? I find people cheat and lie to get a promotion. What should we do? There's a choice you have to make. Choice of advancement, promotion in life, or advancement on the spiritual path. It's a clear choice. Which is of greater interest to you? If you think that current small life, the promotions here matter more, that something you can gain by cheating or lying here means more, go ahead. If you think the spiritual values are more valuable, you will not bother about these things. Now that is a very straight answer. But there's an implication in the straight answer which surprises people. When you give attention to the spiritual and ignore all that and just follow the straight rule of being honest, you get more promotions than the people who cheat and lie. This is something that you don't work it. It doesn't work according to the laws of the world. It works according to a spiritual law. because the master takes care of your journey here also. In my own jobs, people told me to get promotion, you have to do this thing, you have to satisfy this. I never did. I got the maximum promotions. I never did any dishonest act. The people were telling me, if you do this, you will get that. I got that by being honest, not by being dishonest. There is some other power, and we haven't seen the power at work. If you are aware of what a master is, if you come to know who a master is, to whom you are surrendering your decision making, you'll find he takes care of everything inside and out. He's not a master for inside only. He's a master outside and inside. He takes care of everything. Try it out. Thank you very much for this patience with which you have heard the questions, especially the one about my wife, I think. There is a saying in India, using an English word, harmony, it is very conducive to good state of meditation and so on if there's harmony in the house. You all heard the word harmony, but some of you may not know the Indian translation of the word harmony. The Indian translation consists of two parts of this word, harmony, which means har, defeat, money, accept. Accept your defeat right from the beginning, before the argument starts. And there'll be harmony. There's another interpretation of this word harmony, that har in India means necklace, diamond necklace. And money is cash. Give diamond necklace and cash, there'll be harmony.